Roy Tapia, East LA Assassins, the Pit Bull from East Los Angeles, 11-1-2. Roy Tapia, Steve, is a fighter who's coming off a loss to Eric Ruiz in Las Vegas, and he was going back and forth trying to decide, as many fighters when they lose for the first time, what to do next.
I talked to his trainer this morning at the hotel, Gilbert Valdez, and he says the mistake that Tapia made, and we talked about this earlier, he judged a fighter by his record. Eric Ruiz is one of the craftier counterpunchers you'll see at that level. And quite frankly, I think he was a little bit surprised over just how shifty and how crafty Ruiz was, and they ended up getting counterpunched in what was a pretty competitive back-and-forth fight. And Eric Ruiz this time around, according to Valdez, much more focused on the task at hand.
Coming into the ring, there you see him, Roy Tapia, 24 years old, father of two, started boxing at the age of 7. After that loss came against Eric Ruiz in November of 2015. Tapia even put on his Instagram account that he had retired. Then again, you never really do believe anything a fighter says when it comes to the word retirement. So I asked him, like, were you for real about that? Because I unfollowed him. I told him, I was like, dude, you're retired. I'm going to unfollow you. He's like, yo, there was real consideration of maybe doing it. Then I realized this is what I do. And the tail of the tape for Tapia and Rocha.
And we take a look at some of the numbers here. The numbers say very simply, one record is much better than the others. But again, records can be deceiving. But overall, across the board, height, weight, and reach seem to be pretty even between Tapia and Hernandez.
Joe Martinez.
Eight rounds scheduled in the super bantamweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the colors of Mexico, green, white, and red. He weighed an officially 122 pounds, and in 24 professional bouts brings a record that stands at 15 victories, 9 defeats, 8 wins by way of knockout. Hailing from Torreón, Mexico, here is El Peligroso, Jairo Hernandez. And across the ring stands his opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Wearing black trunks, trimmed in gold, he weighed in 121 and 1/2 pounds. His professional record outstanding with 11 victories, 1 defeat, 2 draws, and 6 wins by way of knockout. Hailing from East Los Angeles, California, here is Roy the Pitbull Tapia! Referee in charge of the action is Eddie Hernandez.
Mouthpiece. All right, gentlemen, I've been over the rules with you both. You know what I expect. Touch gloves. Good luck.
Referee Eddie Hernandez with the instructions. We get ready to go. These fighters came in weighing 122 pounds in the super bantamweight division, scheduled for 8 rounds. Thanks for joining us from Indio, California. Bethel Duran, Steve Kim, Golden Boy Boxing Show. Roy Pitbull Tapia in the black trunks from East Los Angeles. You see on the back of his trunks, also on the front of his trunks, his dad, Jose Luis, was a former pro boxer. Started boxing at the age of 7. Roy Tapia turned pro in 2011. Most of his fights have been in California. Only 2 of them haven't. One was in Mexico, and his last one against Ruiz in Nevada. That was the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino on the eve of a Canelo fight. Jairo Peligroso Hernandez, 26 years old. This is the first time he's fighting in the United States. It's also the first time he's working with his new trainer, Daniel Ponce de Leon, the former world champion. They two met because Hernandez kept asking him on Facebook, I want you to train me. I want to change. I don't want to be a journeyman in Mexico. I want to come to the United States. Ponce is from that area. He's from Chihuahua. Hernandez from Torreón, Coahuila, which is close enough. He said, sure, why not? Let's work. And he brought him to the United States 6 weeks ago. They had a great camp. He said, I'm a fighter, also better than my record indicates.
The modern miracle of social media. Beto, you talked about Roy Tapia really kind of contemplating his future. He's just 24 years old. I find that interesting, and I think that may have been him licking his wounds after what was a relatively rough 2015. Mm-hmm. Three fights last year with a record of 1-1-1. It may have been a dose of reality for young Mr. Tapia.
Yeah, step up in competition. Started in 2015 with a draw, and he got a stoppage of Juan Hernandez, and then that split decision loss to Eric Ruiz, a tough veteran fighter from the Oxnard area. And Tapia fighting for the first time since then.
And we take a look at Eric Ruiz. We actually called his last fight on the eve of the Canelo Khan fight on a Friday night. I believe he had to settle for a draw mm-hmm. against another highly touted fighter. Quite frankly, I thought a fight that he may have won. So yep. I don't think necessarily losing to Eric Ruiz should have you contemplating quitting boxing this soon.
Yeah, but when it's the first time you lose, yeah. and that's one yeah. of the knocks on Roy Tapia yeah. is the outside influences on yeah. him. Living in East L.A., is he, you know, you grow up a little bit more as a fighter who has everybody asking you for stuff. And, you know, we've seen it with many fighters, Steve, regardless of where they live, the outside influences. You really want to go run it right now. Tapia said, yeah, I want to come back into the sport. His manager, Caesar, said, let's go. Let's do this then. Got him a fight.
You know, Beto, there used to be a time when you were expected to lose as a young fighter. In fact, there used to be
really?
A saying that this was back when you had to go 45, 50 fights to get your first world title shot, that if you hadn't lost, you probably were not matched tough enough, and you probably were not ready for a world title type of opportunity. It's a different day and age now. There wasn't a lot separating these two guys in round number one or a lot of action, but there's a good counter left hook from Mr. Roy Tapia, and that may have been good enough to give him the edge. I thought that round, Beto, could have gone either way.
Second round of action, Roy Tapia in the black trunks. He has that pit bull in the front. Madeline across his belt, the name of his daughter. He's a father of two young girls, 24 years old. Jairo El Peligroso. He's in the Mexican colored trunks, father of four. Jair, Leonel, Angeline, and Luciana, his wife Natalia, all watching at home. First time he's been away from his family. Said he just have to make that sacrifice. Only 19 amateur fights. He said most of his losses came early in his career. And you hear this a lot from the Mexican fighters because they were taking fights last minute, or they were taking fights above their weight. They were taking fights because they needed money. And, you know, in Mexico, you could turn pro at 16, so they didn't really care for the amateur system much. So it was on-the-job training. Unlike a fighter like Tapia, he had over close to 100 amateur fights.
Boy, and they are both just really digging in, hooks on the inside. And now Tapia doing some pretty good work to the body, and there's a good left hook downstairs by Hernandez. Pretty good action here in round number two.
Yeah, it's always interesting to go in the back in the locker room, Steve, and you see this in whatever sport is you're covering, longtime reporter, what the guy's pre-fight ritual is. Well, Jairo Roca, who's a fighter with the nickname of Peligroso, which is the dangerous one, was reading the Bible. And in the back of his trunks, you'll see the Psalm Isaiah 4:10. So that's what he reads before every single fight.
Well, I think there's that old saying in war, there are no atheists in a foxhole. Keep that in mind.
Like, okay, some guys bump that gangster rap, some guys read the Bible before a fight. It's a beautiful sport. Characters.
Tell you what, I think Tapia's done a nice job of digging in here in round number two. I thought he was a little bit unhinged offensively, but I think in this round he's found something with the left hook to the body and really enforcing his size advantage over Hernandez.
Roy Tapia. In the black trunks. Another case of he took a good amount of months off, wondering will he show any kind of ring rust. He looks solid so far.
No, I thought he's had a very good round number two, and there's a good left uppercut right down the middle, and he's found something there. Remember, he's the bigger guy physically, and he's doing a nice job of making him small on the inside, himself small, a good right hand over the top.
Right hand landed and connected solidly by Tapia. Body work from Hernandez. Good round. More action here in the second. It's scheduled for eight. Tapia loading up and going to that body. A different Roy Tapia looking tonight. If he would have had this kind of aggressiveness against Eric Ruiz, there might not have been any kind of question about
it. No, but it's a different style, though. One thing about Ruiz, he is a classic counterpuncher who reacts to your movement. Here, it's a little bit different. Jairo Hernandez, more of a catcher, and you can see he's having much more success in Tapia. And let's take a look at some of the action from the second frame. Good action as both men come right into the pocket and they dig in. And it was a story of the left hook for Roy Tapia, who really got to work on that punch in the second round. And I thought he did enough work with a few right hands layered over the top to even up this fight. And we take again a look. Just this is where they were for most of the night. And I think Tapia has found something. He can be very comfortable here in forcing his size advantage over Hernandez.
Tapia managed by Cesar Garcia, Black House Boxing. Good job with him, keeping him active. Fighting out of East LA is Roy Tapia. Jairo Hernandez came to the United States, Steve. How about this? Okay, we'll get you some sparring. How about 6 weeks with Leo Santa Cruz as Santa Cruz prepares for Carl Frampton? He served as one of the sparring partners for Santa Cruz for 6 weeks. He said that alone is better exposure and reason to come to the United States. That made him better.
And you know, you take a look at the record of Hernandez. He has a box rack listing of 17-9. As again, both guys just really letting the leather fly here in the third round. But again, you go back to the record. He's faced guys like Andres Gutierrez, Jorge Lara, Miguel Arroyo, and Horacio Garcia, all guys with undefeated records. Again, it's sometimes the records do not tell the story of a fighter.
And he's moving down in weight. Hernandez started boxing at 118 pounds, has fought two of those where he was at 135, he was heavier. Then he finally decided to come back down, and this is more of a better weight for him. Gets caught with the left by Tapia. Tapia looking for that home run, that uppercut. Tapia in the black. And you see down the spine of Hernandez a tattoo that says, "I love boxing." It's always interesting when I ask these guys, what does that tattoo mean? Like, "I love boxing." I'm like, really? Why? Well, I do. I'm like, we know. We know you love it. You're getting in that ring to fight.
Tell you what, I think Hernandez is having a pretty good round number three, taking the play away from Tapia. I think Tapia needs to do a better job of just holding his ground. He's having his most success when he's initiating the contact and coming forward.
Peligroso is a nickname for Hernandez, he said, because when he would fight veteran fighters.
Oh, right hand.
Big right from Tapia. He's saying he didn't go down, but referee jumped in there and said the knee touched, but maybe it was the glove. It happened right in front of you, Steve.
It was either the knee or the glove, and it certainly looked like the right call from the referee. And again, Roy Tapia having more success when he's coming forward and again, leading with the leather.
Yep. That nickname was Peligroso because he was dangerous for veteran fighters. Roy Tapia not having any of that. Tapia is the dangerous one right now in this round as he dropped Hernandez. Another good round for Roy Tapia. Staggers Hernandez here.
Easy on the inside side. Stay composed, Colombia.
He's come at Sergio Estrada, working it. Estrada, a 20-year veteran of the Army. He's seen some. He's an Army medic in the battlefield.
And Beto, we go back to some of the action from round number three. I thought Hernandez had some really good moments, just like this. And again, oh, good left hook to the body. And Hernandez was actually right in this round. And then later on, he was sent to the canvas. And there's a good left hook over the top. Let's see if we get a chance to look at that knockdown that was ruled. And it was right. Well, as we wait for it, right there with the right hand. And if the ropes keep you up, Beto, even if your knee or glove do not hit, that is a knockdown technically.
Hernandez comes out. And that is going to be ruled a slip. Could have been close to being a punch. Hernandez comes out in this round in the green, white, and red as a southpaw. There he goes back to orthodox. He said he's never doesn't like fighting southpaw, but he came out to start that round that way. Fourth round scheduled for eight.
And listening into the corner of Tapia in between rounds, they want volume punching. They think they've taken over this fight physically, and they just want to be able to wear down Hernandez with volume. And you see exactly what they want. Right there, be chest to chest and dig hooks. Work both sides of the body with both the left and the right hand.
His nickname is Pit Bull for Roy Tapia. He's starting to act like one, smothering Hernandez, not giving him any room to operate. Locking in on the veteran Mexican fighter. Body work from Tapia.
And you know what? It seems to me like Tapia is going to try to outwill this tough little Mexican. You could see him just bulling forward now and really trying to impose his size and strength difference.
Heavy breathing from the Mexican fighter in Hernandez. He's in the green, white, and red. Tapia leaning on him. Uppercut, body shot from the pit bull Tapia in East LA. Another left from Tapia. Left by Hernandez. Right and a left landed by Tapia as Hernandez corners yelling him to get out of there.
Yeah.
Another right by Tapia.
And you know what, Hernandez may not have the legs he did a round or
no,
two ago.
He's leaning.
And you know what, his punches don't have the same snap or torque as they did in round number two.
Stiff left from Tapia. Hernandez, he's like he's grown roots. He's not moving around. Finally gets off the ropes. Good action from Roy Tapia, who comes right back on him a minute to go in the fourth round.
Boy, you could see it right here. And a couple seconds ago, Hernandez's legs are really starting to show some wear and tear.
This is the Roy Tapia people talked about 2 years ago, right?
Yeah, this is a good, solid version of him. Again, he has a size advantage. He seems to be a little bit stronger, but really good volume punching. And again, both sides, both hands working high and low and just simply wearing out Hernandez.
That's a good phrase right there, wearing him out. They're telling him, keep your hands up. We're right in the next to the corner of Hernandez.
And you know, Beto, it's simple physics. The guy coming forward or the guy coming downhill is always going to have an advantage physically in terms of the energy expenditure over the guy going backwards. And when you're a smaller guy like Hernandez, I think that aspect is certainly exacerbated.
Roy Tapia, who after his last fight contemplated retirement, this doesn't look like a kid who should have been thinking that way.
And you know what? They're going to have to get to work in the corner above his right eye. I believe there is a cut.
Yeah.
He has composure. That is composure. When you have him against the ropes, when you have him on the left, just listen. When you have him on the ropes, use your fucking angle. Angle to the left, angle to the right.
Animated Gilbert Valdez, Sergio Estrada. There was a cut on the left eyebrow last round. Now he's working on one on the right. Look at that double Q-tip action from Big Serge. Thanks to everybody watching at home on Ring TV Live. Imelda Cervantes had an excellent art show. Congratulations on that in the Valley. South Korea. Entrepreneur, businessman from Compton, appreciate you watching.
The Versace of boxing t-shirt makers, by far.
And he is a softball stud in the making. Fifth round of action is scheduled for eight. Roy Pitbull Tapia, 11-1-2. He's in the black trunks. How do you have it after four, Steve?
I have it 39-36 for Roy Tapia, actually 35, giving him the extra point. I think it's been a very solid workmanlike effort. And we're going to see how are the two cuts going to affect his fight plan moving into the second half here as he actually eats some leather here from Hernandez.
Jairo left from Hernandez. Hernandez did go down in the third round. That's when you mentioned that 35. Coming in as a southpaw now is Hernandez. Something he said he doesn't like doing, but maybe out of desperation. Uppercuts.
You know what, though, Beto? This is not Terrence Crawford. I'm not so sure switch hitting is going to have the same type of effect on Roy Tapia. With a guy like Hernandez who's going to be there, all you're really doing is changing the front side hand. He's not really making himself really elusive, but I tell you one thing, Tapia is still in a fight here.
Hernandez's last three fights, he's shown some power of late. Actually, his last four fights have been stoppages. But those were in Mexico against opponents with suspect records. More blood from the right eye of Roy Tapia. He's cut him both eyes. Body work from Hernandez. Look, Mexican veteran fighters, they know to use that body when they're getting attacked.
Hernandez showing some real craft here. I think in this round, his head movement has improved, and he's actually slipped and evaded a lot of the punches of Tapia. I think thus far, it's been a very good bounce back round number five for Hernandez.
Body shot from Tapia, that's nice. Loaded up on that final seconds of the fifth round. A good scrap between Roy Tapia and Jairo Hernandez in Indio. Roy Tapia in the black. Hernandez, green, white, and red. You see East LA in the back of the trunks of Roy Tapia. Has a crew of kids that follow him around at the gym he works out of called the East LA Assassins. When they're home at the Velasco, they come out with him. It's pretty cool to see that he sees himself as a role model in that gym. Give the kids an inspiration, a chance to dream big and be a professional if they want.
I think you're seeing some hints of fatigue from Tapia starting to really breathe deep just a little bit, and you see his work rate, even though he's picked it up the last minute here, I think for the most part, he has been outworked here in round number five by Hernandez. And we take a look at action from round number five. Hernandez doing some pretty nice counter punching. His head movement was troublesome to Tapia in the last round, able to make him miss a lot. And you see a good counter left hook right over the top. And Hernandez was able to weave some combination as a right hand there from Tapia. The action throughout this night, Beto, I think the best way to put it is steady. I don't think it's ever really let up.
Doctors checking the cut of Roy Tapia. He's cut on the right eye and also on the left one, but the right is, the blood is starting to come out. Sergio started working on it, unable to stop it between rounds there. Doctor check out the eye, they let it go. But that's something that referee is really gonna keep his eye really close on. We're in the sixth round, it's scheduled for eight.
And you can see Tapia early on just closing the distance. Looks like he's trying to reestablish control of this fight physically. Had most of his success, Beto, as he's gone chest to chest on the inside and has dug hooks from up and under with both hands.
Steve, working with you, I've learned styles make fights.
And these two styles make a fight. I don't think there's any doubt about it. Last week, as we saw between Postol and Crawford, you could have two elite prize fighters. Sometimes it takes two not to tango.
1-2 from Tapia. Breathing heavy is Jairo Hernandez in the green, white, and red. Comes from Torreon, Coahuila, right away hooks it with Daniel Ponce de Leon, former world champion, now a trainer and also a commentator for Spanish TV. Look at that, gets a bunch of sponsors immediately. The American dream. That left has landed with ease tonight for Roy Tapia. Tapia made his pro debut in 2011. Hernandez in 2010.
When Tapia misses punches, Beto, for the most part, it's when he's trying to hit big shots over the top. I would just instruct him, aim for the chest down and really work there. That's where he's really been successful for much of the night, being close to the guy and just continually touch Hernandez.
This is Roy Tapia who committed to going to the body, putting together combinations. When you're at the end of a promotional contract, you have to look good. Yeah. I don't know Tapia's deal. I'm just thinking, having been around with Golden for a while, you have to figure out what are they going to do with you. At any promotional company, though, you have to see progress and growth in every fighter. And for a fighter like Tapia coming off a loss, had talked about maybe retiring, not knowing what he wants to do with his career. If I'm his promoter, I'm looking at him like, okay, this guy we can mess with here.
Yeah, well, the one thing I do like about Tapia, and I don't know how high his ceiling really is, Beto, is the fact he makes good fights. Mm-hmm. And again, we can't have it both ways and say that we shouldn't be so hung up on records and then penalize someone for losing. I think, again, tonight has been a good, solid back-and-forth battle here. Does Tapia have the right stuff to really go all the way to the top? Maybe not, because it's more difficult than you think, even with four belts to capture one. But Tapia always seems to give us a very, very honest effort as Hernandez backs him up here late in the round.
Final seconds of the round, that'll do it.
Así tienes que presionar el muerte cuando está dando rounds, tienes que cerrar fuerte. Así como le ganaste este round, así como le ganaste este round, así quiero que se lo gane, se respira. Vamos, bro, usted es un guerrero, vamos. Agarra fácil, pero no te descuides para nada, tu guardia, siempre tu guardia arriba.
Quita la mano de ahí.
Guardia arriba,
Bien, bien, bien.
Tu guardia arriba.
Échale huevos, bro. And we take a look at some of the action that was from the previous 3 minutes. Roy Tapia really made a concerted effort to close the gap and get back to his two-fisted attack to the body of Hernandez, who's been tougher than a combat boot, simply not capitulating. And you see some of the head movement of Hernandez that's made himself a pretty elusive target, at least with the head.
Roy Tapia comes out running right away. Thanks to CJ in Denver watching this fight. Wants me to roll the R's. Hard to roll the R's. Peligroso only has one R. You need to have the R to roll the R. Come on now. Spanish lessons on Twitter. Beto Durant, Steve Kim. I'm Durant Sports. He's Steve UCN Live. Do appreciate all the tweets that we got tonight. Everybody watching on a night full of boxing all over the country. Thanks for joining us here. Do appreciate your support. You can watch the replays in the morning as our fantastic Green TV Live crew gets the fights up immediately.
Beto, you talked about how Roy Tapia at age 24 and not even 15 fights under his belt was contemplating retirement. I could see why, though, and you bear it out tonight. Tapia has a crowd-pleasing style, which is great for us. It's really tough on him physically, though. Even this fight, where I think he's winning and really looked pretty good in spots, it's a tough style, and he doesn't seem to have that true eraser, and he may not have a lot of easy fights left from a physical perspective. This may be what we see from Roy Tapia, who lands a good right hand, that he punched a little bit more, maybe his fights would be a little bit shorter and easier physically, but this is a hard way to make a living, Beto.
Now, Roy Tapia, a lot of heart comes in to fight. He's not going to be a fighter. He's going to stay away from you. He's going to be in there. This is, I think, my fifth fight calling in where he just stands there, and he's willing to trade with you and engage with you. He'll smirk.
Boy, Hernandez has been so game. Just when you think he's about to fold his tent, he comes back with a nice little rally.
He gets hit with a 1-2. Opened up his eyes. He popped those eyes. Seventh round. It's scheduled for a super bantamweight division. Guys weighing 122 pounds.
You know, Beto, I just imagine these type of battles, these pitched grinding affairs, taking place at the Olympic Auditorium 30, 40, 50 years ago on a regular basis with, you know, Don Warrow, Week Shargan, promoted by Eileen Eaton. This has just been a real grind-em-out affair. Good stuff here between these two.
Grinding-out affair. So if you're watching with that carne asada at home, got the ceviche.
And, of course, the tecate.
Of course, tecate. I mean, if you're going to have the michelada, you better get the tecate.
How many other sponsors can we throw at you right now? Carmelita chorizo. We'll do whatever you need right now. This is one where grind it out, and you're going to feel the effects, both fighters, tomorrow.
I mean, whatever they're earning, it's probably not enough. I mean, they really have put in an honest night's work, and it looks like this fight will at least go to the eighth and final round. And I do think Tapia is winning, but if he was honest with you, we talked to him about 30 minutes from now, he would tell you this was not an easy fight.
Final seconds of the seventh round. It's scheduled for eight in Indio. This is the last fight of our Ring TV Live broadcast at around 8:15 tonight on HBO Latino. You'll be able to check out Joseph Diaz Jr. There you see him getting his hands wrapped. There's his dad. Is Joe Chugo with that man bun?
He is. You know what? That's an interesting point. I actually spoke to him about it yesterday.
He got the hair braided?
Well, he did, and I'll tell you why. There's a good reason, very practical reasons, is that he's changed his hairstyle to a longer, floppier look. Old trainers would have their fighters cut their hair if it was too long, because if they got hit and that hair flew around, they always believed that psychologically affected the judges. It made punches look better than they were with the sweat and water flying off. And that's why Joseph did that, so that effect does not happen. Also, doesn't it look good, though?
I'm with you on the first part, on the effect of the judges.
Joseph, Beto Duran said that, hey. Not me.
As a guy who had frosted tips when I was 22.
Whoa.
Why not?
Fernando Vargas fan, huh?
Hey, we all did in the 90s, baby. Roy Tapia in the black. Eighth and final round. Jairo Hernandez from Torreon, Coahuila, Mexico. Green, white, and red. And they're coming out scrapping here in the eighth.
Beto, I have Tapia ahead by 4 points. But if he goes into a four corners, there's going to be one problem. He's much more effective holding his ground and going backwards than he is retreating. I think there's going to have to be a fine balance and a fine line he has to toe between safety and being overcautious here.
Hernandez cornered, led by Ponce de Leon. Daniel Ponce de Leon told him to attack. Well, they know they're behind on the scorecards. Oh, that's been a grind. Got to earn every point tonight, has Roy Tapia. He's dropped Hernandez in the third. Hernandez is up against the ropes. Go back and look at the replay. Probably could have been close to a slip, but you know, you get the glove on the ground or the knee on the ground, immediately ruled a knockdown by law. Stiff jab from Hernandez.
I get the sense that Tapia, his best offense is really a good offense. And you see as he's retreating and maybe being a little bit more cautious, he's actually giving Hernandez an opportunity to build up momentum as he comes forward.
Hernandez wanted to come to the United States to better opportunities, better fights, obviously better payday. They matched him up tough with Roy Tapia, but Hernandez is a fighter you could see coming back against a young prospect and giving him heck.
You know what? He is the type of guy that matchmakers will keep in the Rolodex for one reason, Beto. Number one, he's highly competent and he's durable. He's the type of guy that will give a lot of young prospects this type of work.
He's also somebody that the commission will approve. It's another thing is getting the fight approved by the commissioner and the matchmakers. Javier Razo and Roberto Diaz doing a good job putting together, and the difficulties of trying to match somebody who's undefeated or one loss and the commission to approve it. And Hernandez more than capable of standing in there with you. Less than a minute to go in the fight. Tapia in the black. Cuts on both eyes. Gets tagged with the left.
Oh, Hernandez is having a pretty big eighth round here.
He's going for the home run. They're telling him you need to knock him out. That's what they're telling him in the corner, Hernandez. Hernandez just took a peek at the screen that's behind them to look for how much time. You see a tired Roy Tapia right now. 10 seconds to go in the fight. It's been a good one between Roy Tapia and Jairo Hernandez. East LA and Torreón Coahuila, Mexico.
Gentlemen, after 8 rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. All three have it 77-74. Your winner by unanimous decision, Roy the Pitbull Tapia.
And thank you for watching on Ring TV Live. For Steve Kim, I'm Bethel Duran. We're watching Go The Boy Promotions on Ring TV Live. Tell your